Welcome to the show, everybody. My name is Larry Herb, your host. Xbox Live's Major Nelson is what you know me on. You see me on your console every Friday, and now I'm here in your ears.
I just can't escape you, Larry.
It kind of sounds scary, doesn't it? Hi, Jeff.
Hi.
Hi, Laura.
Hello.
You know, I was talking, I did a Facebook live stream the other day.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
You did.
And there were some people asking, well, hey, we want you to stream on YouTube. And I realized, no, there's too many places you stream on Facebook, on YouTube. We have Beam, there's Twitch, there's everything. But you know what? There's only one guy on your console, and that's me. So that's where my show
take
is.
That, everybody.
So take that, people. Anyway, I'm glad we're back. We got a lot of news this week. Some big news. I was traveling. I was down. Went down to San Francisco, the city by the bay, for the day. Came back. Jeff, you
Tampa?
Love
Tampa? You were in Tampa?
I was. That scary bridge in Tampa. I can't.
Let's not talk about the Sunshine Skyway.
Anyway, so we're going to talk about what we're playing. We're going to give you the news of the week. Phil Spencer's going to come by. I've got an interview with Phil Spencer and ID at Xbox's Chris Charla.
All right.
Wallingford Zone.
Wallingford, which is a part of Seattle. It's a region here in Seattle.
He's there for the skate
park.
It's
a prefecture.
Yes.
So he'll come by. Well, I went down. I had to go down to San Francisco to interview those guys, which is so peculiar because I work with them.
You know, it sounds like it's a peculiar thing, but I've noticed it since I got into the industry 10 years ago, this very year.
Yeah.
There are people that I don't know where they live. I see them in certain meetings. I see them at events. And then I assume that they live in places like LA or whatever. And it's like, no, I live in Seattle.
Yeah.
And it's just sort of like this thing where we're kind of like, we have heads down and we're working and we're doing stuff. And
we
then
go to an event.
You don't look up sometimes until you're at an event. And then you're just like, oh, I've just seen you again.
Speaking of events, we got PAX East coming up. We'll talk about that later in the show.
What a segue.
Boston. Laura's going to be there. I'm going to be there. Jeffrey's going to be there.
City also by a bay, maybe? The harbor?
It is. Well, it's Boston Harbor between the Cape Cod. Cape Cod Bay.
City by the harbor.
Harbor. So
I can't compete.
Yeah, sure you can. Give me a y'all.
Yo.
There we go.
I'm going to South by after that.
Yeah. There we go. Anyway, why don't we jump in, talk about what we're playing, and then we'll kind of rattle off some of those headlines earlier. Jeffrey, did you finish it?
Did I finish what?
Firewatch.
Yeah, I did.
Yay!
I watched Mia Fire. Yeah.
I talked to him earlier in the week. He's like, I'm going to go play Firewatch. Oh, and because he wanted to finish it for the show. So I respect that you hit your goal.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Yeah, I appreciate that. That was one of the games from last year that was sort of right on the very top of the pile of shame. And everyone's like, it only takes a couple of hours.
Yes, it is.
It took me maybe three or four. It's a good game. Mm-hmm. I would say.
Did you play it, Laura?
Yes, I did.
Okay.
The less I tell you, the better. But ultimately, I would say if you liked games like Gone Home, if you liked games like Oxenfree, I felt like there was a little bit of both in this game. I love the color palette, has a distinct style. And actually, Campo Santo, who developed the game, won an IDF award or IDG award. They won a GDC award yesterday.
For the game?
Yeah, for the game.
Fantastic.
Best newcomer. So congrats to Campo Santo. Firewatch,
yes.
Very enjoyable.
Yeah, it was. I need to get back. I mean, this is a story. Look, we got so many games to play right now, Laura. It is just ridiculous how many games we have to play.
There's just the stack is so big.
Jeff and I have been playing Overwatch. Of course, that's kind of the
new little plucky little indie, which actually won Game of the Year. Well deserved at GDC.
Awesome. Yeah.
And it just keeps bringing us back.
Yeah. It's just we get in there, they tweak it more, and we got to play that out.
Can we talk about Bastion?
Do you want to talk about what they did to Bastion?
What Bastion did to everyone else is what you mean.
Well, they're undoing it. You saw that.
But they might be. We'll see.
Okay.
It sounds from the tone of your voice, Larry, that Bastion was your go-to character.
No. Actually, I didn't play him a lot.
He's
right now, he's really overpowered.
Well, yeah.
Really overpowered.
Well, it's one of these things where, like, everyone was using Bastion at first, and then very quickly, people realized, oh, Bastion is very easily countered. Pharah would take him down. I would always get killed by Tracer, would always just sneak around behind you. But so they buffed Bastion significantly. Like, I feel like he never runs out of ammo in sentry mode. And you can now run around and heal at the same time. It used to have to be something you would stop.
Really?
So if I was like, if I took a hit from afar, I would go behind a wall and I would.
Because you're exposed when you're healing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now you can heal while you're walking. And I got into a one-on-one with Zarya yesterday.
Who's a tank.
Who's a tank and doesn't have the strongest gun. Zarya couldn't kill me because I just hold down the left trigger. They move the heal.
Wait a minute. Is that the time I was healing you as well.
Oh, was that happening?
Yes, I was mercy. I was healing.
I was like, you can't hurt me. And eventually she just gave
up. You were in the corner, right?
I was,
because it was Nubani. That's right. I do remember.
Yeah, it was Nubani. Yeah. And I'm like, wow, she did not kill me. And eventually she turned around. I'm like, I'm going to just shoot you in the back.
Right.
Now.
Boom.
And it was not honorable, but we won. Actually, we had good night yesterday. So I guess they're going to, I think they may have indexed a little bit too high, and I think we'll see some tweaks. Jeff Kaplan, who is the face of...
I need to get Jeff on the show. I got a lot of people on the show.
Yeah.
I need to get him on the show.
He's provided us so much enjoyment.
By the way, you were talking about, I'm sorry, I want to go back to Firewatch. I had Sean Veneman in from...
Oh, yeah, that's right.
From
Camposanto.
So he's on, yeah. I'm just looking here, show number 580, if you want to roll back and listen to that podcast.
Well, I should bring up the notes.
So long ago. Anyway, sorry, we'll get back into what we're talking about.
So, well, you know, we were looking and we were actually, yesterday we were playing and they've changed around. I think it was the Numbani map and there's like robot parts all over and where you're sort of, you know, where you're hanging around before you spawn. And here, and we're like, oh, new character must be coming soon.
Yes.
And
today,
here we are. Overwatch's new hero is Orisa, who is like a tank character. I like a tank character.
Now, did you watch? You haven't seen the trailer yet, have you, Laura? Because it just came out a day or so ago.
I've not seen it.
Jeff, you watched it.
No, there was the origin, and then there's the developer update, but I haven't really seen much about it.
Because I watched the video, and. The video is in this. It's very. It's nice. There's not gameplay video, but if you listen to the voiceover, I am because it's very light. So it's like a child's voice delivering it, and that. So I actually wrote the script down here, and because I wanted to read it as you could. It's all in the way you deliver the message.
Oh yeah.
In a child's voice, it sounded kind of fun and fancy, but if you read it like this, the same exact words take a different meaning. May I?
I just like to say that we don't know what Larry's going to say.
Okay. I have no idea.
Well, this is the text from the video that was released on Thursday where they released the new hero. So I copied it down and I wanted to read it in like Mr. Announcer big evil voice. The world is a scary place. Even here in Nubani, we needed something to protect us. Enter the defense bots. They took the older model and gave it a complete makeover. That kept us safe for a while. I was at the airport when Doomfist attacked. Poor bots did not stand a chance. Everyone else gave up on you. But I saw what you could be. So, I rebuilt you. Upgraded your programming and gave you a heart. Orisa, I made you strong and brave. You still have a lot to learn. And you'll probably mess up sometime. But I know what you'll do. Orisa. You are the hero we need. Now, that was...
Wow.
Now, get the grabby people on the phone.
No, I'm just saying, is because if you listen to her... Go play it. Go play it right now.
All right.
Because I want Laura to hear it. But I'm just saying, because I was listening to this voice. Put the microphone down towards it.
That's the wrong one.
This is it. Okay. If you can do it. Or
how much did you practice that, Larry?
That's my first read. Listen to this, so... There's a couple words I dropped.
It's a scary place.
I can't hear the difference.
Even here, Nubani.
We needed something to protect us. I don't know what she said there.
They took the old Adina model from the crisis
and gave them a complete makeover.
They kept
us safe for a while.
For a while. I was at the airport when Doomfist.
I never realized how much you sound like Soldier 76 until just now.
Get off my lawn. Anyway. I wanted to take, because she's got such a wonderful delivery there. I'm like, let's just take the same words and
so
make it evil.
They've, you know, the original guy, I can't remember
I don't
his
know
name
why
right
I
now,
did that.
Who would do all the,
in a world.
Yeah, in a world. Like that guy, he passed away a few years ago, and there's like someone else who's not quite as good. I think you need to just like, fist fight him and take over the trailer.
Oh, well, actually, the best guy is, I think we've talked about Ernie Anderson, right?
No.
Ernie Anderson's an old school announcer. He used to do the ABC. This is ABC. You'd recognize your voice if you heard him. There's some YouTube videos of him doing it. He's a consummate professional. Anyway, no, I was watching the trailer the other day when it came out, and I was like, what if it's the same words, but you just deliver them in a different style, and they take a completely different meaning.
Absolutely.
It goes from save the world to kill the world. Anyway.
Are you the final boss? Are you Doomfist?
Maybe I am.
All right. Sorry
about
that.
We'll link out to Arisa. Arisa looks like a really cool character. And so.
And if you need me for voiceovers, you can contact at Jeff Rubenstein on Twitter. He's my agent.
Take a flat 10%.
So, all right. Where are we?
Can I be your agent? I want
10%. Well, I don't know. I don't know if he can be. I mean, religious speaking, you know, just more attuned to be. But you can be.
What?
What? You have agent background.
I suppose I do. I'm somewhere. Actually, I am related to a casting agent.
See? I knew it. Right. I knew it. Laura, you're welcome. You're welcome to be my agent.
I don't have the
You're welcome to be. Anyway, enough about that. Moving along. Is that all you played? Not that all you played, but you played Firewatch and Overwatch? Because I want to get to Laura.
Because
I know what she played.
Yeah, we talked about it.
Played a bunch of Fallout Shelter. That's it. Since it came out on Windows 10, it's just totally like, oh, I have 10 seconds. Let me just go ahead and load this up and get some working my way towards achievements.
Right.
That one's still fun.
Right.
Riptide GP Renegade. We talked about that one last week. That is a XPA game, Xbox Play Anywhere. So you can play it on Windows 10 and on Xbox One. I've been doing that. We didn't talk about Sniper Elite. We were playing together.
You did play it together.
We played it together.
Fantastic.
And you know what? Two snipers are better than one.
We had a great time.
Really?
I think so. Well, did we? I don't want to speak for you, Jeffrey.
Like we were like back to back. I felt like two Charlie's Angels and like just cutting our way through the Nazis. It was just a lot of fun. And occasionally one of us would go a little too far, Larry, and you know, the other one have to rein him back in.
Vice versa.
You know? Mm-hmm. But I would say co-op totally changes
as always.
For the best. It makes it really fun. So yeah, that was my favorite thing last week.
We did that. Laura, what are you playing? Then we'll get to what I'm playing.
Yeah, sure. Uh-huh. So I've been playing Halo Wars 2. Still.
Yes. Oh, yeah, that's right.
Still cranking through some of the campaign. Still really fun.
Yep.
Enjoying it.
As am I.
Yeah. I also decided I need more motivation for my workouts.
Mm-hmm.
So I started playing Dance Central Spotlight.
Okay.
Hmm.
Now, Jeff, you don't remember what happened with Dance Central, do you?
Well, I played Dance Central.
No, you don't know what happened. You don't remember the PAX Seattle massacre.
No.
May I?
Sure.
Laura challenged me once on this very show. This is before you joined us, and I mistakenly took the bait. And we
before we had talked a lot about Dance Central.
Right.
And how I was obsessed with it.
Right. You still are, obviously. And we went a dance off on the stage on the main Dance Central stage in front of God, the world, and everybody. And I got my clock cleaned. So. Oh, God, I hope there's not video of that. I'm sure there's video.
I'm
looking for it right
please
now.
Please do not. Anyway, you're playing Dance Central. That's good for you, Laura.
Yes, so it's out for Xbox One. And I hadn't actually played a lot of this game, but finally came back to it because I would like to become more healthy. And Dance Central is a great way to do aerobic exercises.
Right.
And if you're also interested in trying it out, another good, awesome pro tip is you get lots of achievements.
Yeah, you do. Why? I can't believe. Wait a minute. Did you not have these achievements already?
No.
This is why I'm so stunned, because you played the heck out of that game.
I did. I played a lot of Dance Central 2.
Right.
I hadn't played that much Spotlight.
Oh, okay.
A bunch of other games.
Right.
And I just lost track of it.
I see.
And so now I've gone back to it and am playing through the songs there.
What's your favorite song to dance to? Do you have one?
Well, last night I was playing Happy by Pharrell.
Okay.
And that one, I was just trying to get all the moves.
Jeffrey, don't even tell me you found it.
I found a video of Laura doing the robot.
That's
from PAX East, isn't it?
2011.
So embarrassing.
Yeah, that's right.
Link will be provided.
It's a good robot. It's a good
robot.
There's
some popping. There's some locking. There was a lot going on
here. Wow, that's so embarrassing. Just one of the moments you regret, that's one of them.
Really?
Yeah.
If that's the only moment you have to regret, trust me, you've got some growing up to do.
That's one of them. I got a rare achievement, which I was super excited about. Have you guys gotten a rare achievement?
Yes.
Yet?
Yeah, we got a couple of them. Did we get one in Sniper Elite? No, I got a couple in Halo Wars. So do you like the audio? Because I worked on that.
Love it.
Thank you.
Great.
I worked on the audio and the animation with the team at Rare and our platform team here. I remember in a this is true. I don't think I've ever told this story. We were in a meeting and they presented one, which was kind of this, like when we were getting ready to work on Rare Achievements, and then we kind of had the animation down and they were working on the sound, and I just didn't like the sound. I'm like, they played it, and I said, play it again. And I said, hold on a minute. I go out to YouTube and I said, this is what it sounds like. And I played them a clip from Antique Roadshow. Do you remember when they finally reveal how much whatever the antique is worth, and it goes ring, and the little treasure chest spins around the bottom?
Right.
That's what it sounded like.
Oh, no.
And I said, I don't want it to sound like Antique Roadshow.
I'm sure that actually made your point.
So it did. So
yeah, I remember you coming into the office.
Do you remember I was talking about
five
that?
Of them, and like some of them, it would go like, yay!
Yeah.
You know, we're like, baby.
But this one, I said what my description, and I think maybe I said this on the show before when we were working with the audio team. So I said, I want it to be audio confetti.
Audio celebration.
Right. It's got to be fun, exciting. Anyway,
yes.
So I'm glad you got one.
Yeah, very good. The one that I got was getting a 32X multiplayer in a pro or deluxe. So they've changed their difficulty settings.
Right.
It used to be easy, medium, hard,
mm-hmm.
expert.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's standard, deluxe,
mm-hmm.
pro,
mm-hmm.
and then they keep going with different
types. They need one below that. Like overweight white guy
oh,
for
no.
me.
Sit and be fit.
Sit and be fit. That's great. And then I went through the whole achievement list, and it looks like there are a lot of rare achievements still left to do.
Now, did you notice something in rare achievements? No, you probably don't. This is the first one you've gotten, right?
This is the second one.
Okay. We changed it this past week.
You did?
Yeah. We now do decimals. So you used to say it was 1%. Now we can see your 2% or 5%. Mm-hmm. Now you'll see 3.72%.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So
I had scrolled on all the way to the bottom for the Dance Central achievements. I found a 0.01.
Is that the one you're going after? What is? Do you remember what it is?
Just the harmonics team did it.
I bet it's just people from the harmonics team. I think
it was just Annette's the only one that has it.
Probably. That's to unlock all moves in the game.
Right. Right.
Some of the moves are really hard.
Yeah.
There's a bunch. If you want to see the animation, I would say play Lovers in a Dangerous Space-Time on co-op. Makes the game mm-hmm. a lot easier.
Mm-hmm.
And on easy level, which makes the game a lot easier, there's a bunch that you can unlock that are rare. Because we got like four in a day. And since me, my brother, and my kid were all logged in, we saw that animation like repeatedly.
Yeah,
like,
boom, 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 boom.
One after another.
Firing like crazy.
Yeah.
Fun.
Super satisfying when you unlock one of those. So if you haven't a chance, try out dancing.
Got a little diamond animation we worked on. I'm so glad you liked it. I'm so glad we haven't talked about that.
Yeah, it's great. So I guess that's it for me.
Oh, yeah. On my side, of course, I will talk about traveling to San Francisco. Overwatch, Sniper Elite 2, Gwent, the Witcher card game, playing a little Gwent.
Oh, you are?
Yeah.
It's really good.
Yeah, I'm having fun with that.
Great.
Last weekend was Tom Clancy's Ghost Recon Wildlands, that beta. We did that. Jeff, you and I didn't play that, did we?
We played the alpha.
We played the alpha or the closed beta or whatever it was.
Yeah. It's coming out really soon.
Yeah. So we played that. I'm continuing my Witcher 3 Wild Hunt story because I'm working on the DLC. Well, the DLC.
Still going through? Oh.
The DLC.
We talked about that last
time. Halo, yeah, well, the DLC is like, it's a game unto itself. Playing Halo Wars 2, still cooking along on that. Resident Evil 7 Biohazard, which, did you finish that?
No, I got to go back to it.
For Honor, I'm hitting that up. I mean, it's
there's a lot there.
There's a lot going on. So
many games.
And then even
Recon's
more
Tuesday.
Pardon me?
Ghost Recon's Tuesday.
Yeah, so Ghost Recon is this Tuesday. You know what comes out this week?
Oh,
the Nintendo Switch.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Did you pre-order yours, Laura?
I did not.
Did you, Jeffrey?
I did.
Okay, I didn't because when they went up for pre-order, I was like on an airplane or something.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't have one. I will not have one.
Well, I'll bring it in. Okay. Actually, I'm going to bring it to PAX, which is the timing's
great.
Good.
But
the reviews for Zelda are still.
Yeah, the reviews.
So I'm really excited.
Congrats to those guys.
Yeah.
Shipping games
right
is hard.
Down the street. Yeah.
Yeah.
And yeah, I somehow missed. I missed the Wii U, so it'll be fun getting back. It's all, new hardware's fun.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
It's always fun.
Yeah.
So we'll take a look at that. I'm sure we'll talk about that once we get our hands on the hardware. But that's fun coming out this week. But a lot of games came out. A lot of ID at Xbox came out of the past week and a half or so.
I got a bunch. There's new releases. A bunch came out of GDC.
You right.
Hit the stinger and I'll go.
Should we? Dun, 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 dun. Here's the news.
Yes, thanks very much, Larry. Big news coming out on Monday, and that was Middle of Earth, Shadow of War. Yes.
Now, Laura, do you remember that? Because I know you were into this.
Yes, I was.
And we, I found out about this about a day before and I forgot to tell you, so I apologize.
Well, I mean,
you
the trailer.
You ended up finding out.
I did.
That's
I watched the trailer
important.
When they announced it. So excited for that.
Yeah.
Excited.
Something I like. They announced the game. They announced that it was Xbox One and Windows 10, mm-hmm. which is kind of great, and obviously Scorpio as well, and a date, August 22nd. So
really
already
soon.
Draw the line in the sand. Like holiday starts like with this game. So
that's really that's right around PAX Seattle.
It should be, yeah, maybe a couple of days before that. So we should have, and the game is, I believe, made very nearby here.
Yeah, it's actually up near my house, up in Monolith, up in Brooklyn. Yeah.
So if you want to like, peer in the windows, let me know how
you know,
it works.
Well, maybe we'll take the show down there. We'll do an interview.
That'd be really cool.
We should all go down there. Want to all go down to Monolith? All right, I'll work on that.
I would love to
work on that.
Yeah. The Shadows of Mordor was amazing. And, and
you played, did you finish that?
Yes, I think I
did. I remember you were just all into that. I loved it, but I just, you got caught up in the story. Well, the story and the whole thing, which is great.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I thought it was a fantastic telling of that story.
Yeah. Fantastic. Oh, absolutely. It filled in all those gaps, and this one looks like it's going to be really cool as well. The Nazgul, like the Wraith, seem to have a pretty major role. And then you now command an orc army. So, like, you possessed all those orcs with the Nemesis system in Shadow of Mordor, and now I think you have one, and you take it on, and you'll end up facing another one. So that could be really
fun.
Cool.
Fun.
Yes. So it was GDC. Oh, right before GDC started, also.
Yeah.
We announced Xbox Game Pass.
Now, this is a huge, or as some people
don't
say.
Don't do it. Don't do it, Larry. Don't do it. You were just coming off presidential.
I know.
This is a very large program we're very excited about. It's going to be available to preview members now. Jeff, why don't you give some of the details?
Yeah. So basically, think of Xbox Game Pass is something like an all-you-can-eat with over 100 games at any time. So for $9.99 a month, you get unlimited access to over 100 Xbox One and backwards compatible Xbox 360 games. We've mentioned some of the developers and the publishers, games like Halo 5 and NBA 2K16, Mad Max, Saints Row 4, a lot of great games, and games will cycle in and out. But the thing that I think really makes this sing is that not only is it Xbox One games as well as Xbox 360 backward compatible games, but you download it.
Yeah.
So you're not going to be reliant on, you know, bandwidth, you know, at any given point to, you know, determine your, you know, what your performance is like. You're going to be able to download it. You can play it like
full
every other
fidelity.
Game. Yes. So, you know, and some of the publishers that are involved are 2K, Namco Bandai, Capcom, Deep Silver, Sega, Warner Brothers, who makes Shadow of Mordor, Shadow of War, Microsoft Studios, of course. So a lot of great games coming, and we're going to be sharing more in the coming weeks. But right now, if you're the people that will they can sort of look at it first, or those in Xbox Insider program.
Yeah, so we'll be coming to everybody, all Xbox owners, soon. Don't know the exact date, but it'll be coming later this year.
And you'll find out here.
In fact, Phil talked about that. So why don't we take a break here? I'll roll the interview I did with Phil and Chris, where he talks a little bit about Game Pass, as well as some of our GDC news. And then on the other side of this, we'll have Jeff kind of go over that news again. How's that sound?
Sounds great.
Let's do it.
As promised, I'm down here in San Francisco at the ID at Xbox event. Joining me is Phil Spencer and Chris Charla. Hey guys, how you doing?
Great. How's it going?
It's going well. You can't see it, but Larry and Chris are sharing a microphone.
Well, yeah, so every you're the time boss, you get your own. Every time we're going to pass it back and forth, right, Chris?
I think it's just awesome.
Yeah, it's very, very natural.
Let's see if we can try to get them to talk at the same time.
Anyway, first of all, I want to thank you guys. I know you've had it's a busy week. We're down here at Game Developer Conference, GDC, and we've had some great announcements this week. And I thought, I figured I'd come down here because you guys wouldn't meet with me back in the office. So I flew all the way down here just to interview you guys to kind of go over the headlines. So I thought we could do that.
Sounds good to me.
See, they didn't talk at the same time again. Yeah, it's great. You
know, or we can get in really close like this, and it's really...
We can talk at the same time.
But anyway, so I want to kind of go over what we announced and what's going on here at Xbox. Let's start with you, Phil.
We're at the ID at Xbox event, which is always my favorite event of GDC, because I get to come down, see a bunch of developers that are building new games, trying new things. I love the ID space because you have developers that aren't afraid to experiment, aren't afraid to try to kind of push the boundaries of what gaming's about.
Yep.
And then we get people to come in and play the games. And I love coming down early. I'm always here when they open. And
you're the first guy in.
I'm standing in line, you're before
the first guy in.
Pressed up against the glass. Chris lets me in. Says he always lets me in third. I can't go in first. But I love it down here.
Now, would you kind of do a scene setter? Because obviously this is audio. So we're in a special space here in San Francisco. We've got a bunch of game points set up. Talk about that.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to start with the space because I've. Is Chris going to talk about it?
No, I'm just getting ready.
No, I want Chris to talk about it.
The space is awesome. It's super cool. Like, I don't even, you know what it is. I don't even know. This is just some weird space that we come to.
Well, we as the Xbox team grabbed a space in New York and a space in San Francisco actually before the Xbox One launched.
That's right.
And we set them up as kind of living room experiences. Once we launched and Chris got a hold of all of this, we took all the living room stuff out and we make them game spaces. So it's an old garage. So I think this was actually an auto repair garage before we took it over. We've had it for a few years, but every year I'm down here, it's usually some kind of press event or an ID at Xbox event. Cement walls, very industrial.
Is there a car lift?
There's that. There probably used to be. There's what there is awesome is these amazing like laser cut iron things everywhere that all include an Xbox logo. It's really fantastic.
Yeah. No, this is the team that put this space together does a great job. The thing I love, because and I want to thank all the ID at developers that come here because we know this. They sit in this space as cool as we think it is. I imagine after the 20th hour, it's probably a little less cool being in here. At least they keep it temperature-wise cool. But these developers sit by their stations while press comes by, enthusiasts come by, play the games, get feedback. Random people like me come by. And you can see in the morning they're all enthusiastic, and you can come by at the 12th hour and they're still enthusiastic about showing their game, talking to you, even those random questions about, hey, why is that blue and why is that purple? And the energy level is always great. And I think that they just do such a great job showing their game and showcasing what we're trying to do at Xbox. So thanks to all of them.
Yeah, I also want to point out this is a private invite-only event that we do for media and partners, right? So these are games that are coming out later this year or in the future, right?
As we know, trying to guess when they're going to come out with some of these ID games, see Cuphead, isn't always the easiest thing. But we can ask Chris when these games will ship.
They will ship when they are ready to ship. Now we don't dictate release dates to developers. They tell us when the game's ready to come out, and we support them.
And then they tell us again when it's a different date.
Yeah, that's right.
All right. Well, let's focus on what we have here now, Chris. I want to go to you because I want to talk about what we're showing off here in terms of specific titles and maybe, you know, some of the highlights. I mean, there's so many titles to go through, and I'm sure that people are watching their favorite gaming sites to see what some of their favorite games are. But can you give us some of the highlights?
Yeah, sure. I mean, we're showing like 22 games, so I can't run down the exhaustive list, or I could, but you'll probably start kicking me.
He has
me.
A list in front of him on a piece of paper, so he actually can.
But we have a convenient blog post that anyone can go to see a list of all the games, and you know, there's some amazing ones here. Some that are brand new that we haven't shown before. One is Ooblets, which is a really cool new game.
Winner.
That is, I guess, a combination of kind of Harvest Moon meets Animal Crossing plus Pokemon. It's
is this a real dark themed one?
Yeah, no, it is not the real dark themed one. It is a very like happy, light.
It would be the opposite of dark themed.
However, directly across from it is an extremely dark game
from Poland.
Yeah, from Poland, which is a super cool sort of horror game that I think like Interchains, which is super dark. But really cool, and it kind of shows the diversity of the program that we have games from, you know, from Interchains to Ooblets to Path of Exile to Super Mega Baseball.
Yeah, I love seeing Path of Exile come to the platform. It's a game I played on PC for quite a while. It's got a really good following on PC. I was talking to them about bringing it to console, how they moved over to controller. Even they were surprised, I think, with how the game showed up when they actually brought it over, put controller on it. Game looks really, really good. Team's done a fantastic job.
Now, Phil, I don't have a lot of time because I know you're busy and you're running out of here. But I want to kind of get to a couple things and talk about the ID at Xbox program and how it fits into the broader portfolio and how you look at it as the head of Xbox. How do you look at ID at Xbox versus everything else?
Yeah, I mean, I know you throw out the word versus, but I'm going to pick on that for a second because I actually don't see it as a versus thing. I think as somebody who's been in the game industry now for quite a long time, I think we see creativity and diversity come from many places. We see it come from AAA. We see it from new business models. And I think we can see it from small teams, maybe developers that worked at a bigger studio and had a passion for what they wanted to go build. The Ooblets game you talked about, I love talking to the developer. It's a man and a woman. It's two people who are the whole studio. I think they're in New Hampshire, if I remember correctly. And they've got a passion for a game that they want to go build. What I love is our ID program, and Chris has been the spirit of this for us, and other platform holders have done a great job with indies as well. Steam, Sony's done a good job. But now these people, unlike maybe 10 years ago, these smaller studios have an avenue to get to the largest audience. Obviously, they can ship on PC. Now they've got a way to bring these games to console, and I think it's a great opportunity for them, and most importantly, it's a great opportunity for the gamers to get their hands on more and more games, which is really what it's all about.
Now, moving forward a little bit, this week we're in town for GDC, and Chris, I wanted you to go through some of the announcements. We're actually recording this before the announcement, so...
So this is a leak.
Well, it's not a leak, as long as no one gets a hold of this audio file early. But we're recording this a little bit early, but I want to see if you can kind of go through, because this will post afterwards. What are some of the announcements we have this week? There's a lot of stuff coming out of GDC.
Yeah, we're going to be announcing a lot. One thing we're going to be announcing is a new program called the Xbox Live Creators Program. And it's a pretty interesting new program. And what we're doing is we're actually opening up Xbox Live so that anyone can go to MSDN, download Xbox Live, implement it in their UWP game, and ship that game on Windows 10 or on Xbox One in a completely open fashion.
So this is like, back to Phil, your idea of a game is a game is a game, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think... Even more than a game is a game, that's included in this, is the fact that when I play games, I want to be connected to the community of friends that I play with.
Right.
And we know that some developers coming in aren't coming in through the ID program. Maybe they're taking their own path to developing their game. And we wanted to make sure that even on the Windows platform and, you know, wherever in the end they might want to be, that they're able to access Xbox Live. Now, it's not full of Xbox Live, and I'm sure when we talk about this, because there are certain things about Xbox Live that we want to protect.
Sure.
But all up, we want these games to be able to connect into Xbox Live and reach the rich social network that's there of gamers.
Now, Chris, how do people get into it? How do they get involved? What are the options?
So it's really easy. They can go sign up, and I think they're taking a limited audience this week, and then it'll broadly open up to everybody within a couple months, and they can just... download Live, start implementing the SDK, and then ship a UWP. On PC, the game will just ship into the PC, the Windows Store. On Xbox One, you know, we had to be thoughtful, and you know, there's a lot of debate about curation versus openness. Console players expect a curated store environment, and we didn't want to change that. We want to open up the Xbox to development, but we don't want to, you know, change that. So on Xbox One, the store will remain the same curated store, and there'll be a special section for these Creators Program games where people can go in there and see everything the world has to offer.
Yeah. So this actually builds on one of the original ideas, Phil, that the team had, which is taking a regular console and turning it into a dev kit, right?
That's right. I mean, I think the opening up development of console games to everybody is just going to lead to more creativity coming to the space. And as Chris talked about, we want to make sure that gamers know, I'm going to say, what they're getting themselves into. I don't mean that that's a bad thing, but this is an uncurated space. And we wanted to make sure, like, if you're a parent, hey, here's the stuff that might be in this space, and you know, you can make your own decisions about that, the level of kind of quality, fit and finish, or whatever it is. But we also know some great things started from a seed that built. And I think you'll see a lot of those kind of game ideas come to this space.
There's a lot going on. I also want to talk about, I you know, even though we're down here at GDC, some news that went out earlier this week was Game Pass.
Yeah.
And that's we've been seeing a lot of good pickup on that, haven't we? You're pretty happy with that.
Yeah, you know, Game Pass is something that we've had in our heads for quite a while. This idea that we could give Xbox gamers access to a large catalog of games for, I mean, some people say a lot, some people say a little, but I think a fair monthly fee.
Yeah.
And they're getting 100 games. In the U.S., it's $9.99 a month, I think, basically $10 a month. You get access to 100 games. And, you know, I saw some of the questions online, and some people are asking, because it is true that certain games will come into the program for a little while, certain games will go out of the program for a while. But obviously, our motivation behind this is that a majority of the games are there month in and month out.
Sure.
We just know some publishers will make decisions, so we wanted to be transparent about when games would be there. But the response has been fantastic.
Yeah.
One of the things that we didn't talk about that I'd like to take a second and talk about, because I think there's an opportunity here for this to not just be about games that have already shipped. I'd actually like to see this grow to a program that you could see frontline games, first shipped games, come into Xbox Game Pass as something, as a way that they get distributed. And I think you've seen this in the TV space with, like, Netflix. You've seen Netflix at first was really about movies or TV shows that I might have missed, and I subscribe to Netflix and I go watch it. Now some of the best TV out there is actually being created as Netflix originals, Amazon originals, HBO's doing the same thing. And I'd love to see us be able to grow Game Pass to a program where maybe, like, episodic and smaller story-based games could see this as a way that they actually launch, because obviously there's a business model behind Xbox Game Pass, and I think it could really support that. Best thing for me, parent walks into the store, they buy a console for a fairly minimal monthly amount, they're able to get access to 100 games for everybody in the family.
I want to point out that that went to a limited preview audience this week.
Yeah.
And it's going to come out, you know, to everyone later on this year.
And the people who are in preview, as always, you know, there might be some bumps. That's what being in preview is about.
Welcome to the world.
Yeah, it's a limited catalog of games in the beginning. But I thank those people for the time they spend running our preview builds on their console and helping us out as we test new features. But yeah, this is a feature I've really wanted to bring to Xbox. And it's nice to be able to bring it. I'd love to be able to bring it to more and more platforms. I know in the Q&A there was a little bit about Windows. I think a long-term vision here is that we'd be able to bring a service like this to every platform where we ship games.
Yeah, and I know I'm sure ID at Xbox guys would like to get in there too, wouldn't they?
Yeah, we have a bunch of ID at Xbox games that'll be launching.
So it's pretty much for anybody. Now, Phil, we're down here at GDC. We're talking about all the great stuff this week, the creators update and some of the other things. You're meeting with some developers. What do you see? There's a lot going on in the space. So we're like mixed reality. We call augmented reality or virtual reality. What's going on in that space in your head?
I see a ton of creativity going on as people are trying to build things. And I think really trying to find what I call the vocabulary of what games in that space are like.
Right.
You know, simply taking the camera that might be in a first-person game and making that
putting it on your head.
And, you know, that's a learning experience as well for all of us, whether it's motion sickness or whatever, and trying to figure out how that works. I was over in Japan last week, and I saw some developers that were trying new things. And all of them that I see are starting on Windows, right? It's a very open space for them to try. And I like our news this week that we're really liberating that development, trying to bring down the price point, make mixed reality just a default place on part of Windows where anybody can go off and build mixed reality experiences. In the fall, we talked about the lower price points for the HMDs that we'll be supporting.
Head-mounted displays.
Sorry. Yeah, and it's a place where we were going to start that motion. Right now, it's about development on Windows, which I think is great. Our longer-term plan would be to bring this to all Windows 10 devices, including Xbox.
What have you played lately in the VR MR space that you like?
You know, it's funny.
This is not an announcement about it coming to Xbox. I just want to be very clear, everybody.
No, I'm actually, this is not something people can go buy. But when I was in Japan last week, one of the stops I had was at Namco Bandai. Yeah. And they have these VR experiences. They put it in their arcades. And so you pay, I don't know how much it is, but you stand in line, and it's almost like a ride.
Right.
But they had this one Gundam experience that was just really cool. Like you walked into a park, and there was the good
robot. Did you do it?
Yeah, I did it.
Yeah.
And there's this hydraulic couch that you actually end up, like you don't, when you have the head-mounted display on, it looks like the hand of the robot that you go and sit in, and you kind of hug the thumb, and you get kicked way up in the air. And then while you're in the air, there's this battle between the two robots that are like,
and you're getting tossed around.
You're getting thrown around. It was really, really well done. Like I don't know if it was a game, but as an experience, you felt the sense of height. You spent the sense of immersion that I think VR has done a great job in bringing to gaming. And it was just one of those experiences that I felt, you know, you could really tell a story that would land in a very fundamental way with somebody using this as kind of the medium
and
for that.
I think it's interesting to point out is that a lot of folks may not know this, but the arcade scene over in Japan is just crazy. It's still on fire.
Still there.
It? Right. And you've been over there, right, Chris? You know what it's like.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
That's it.
I like going to Japan and getting destroyed at multiplayer fighting games in arcades, and then the person stands up because in Japan the fighting games are back to back.
Yeah.
So you're playing across from the person, and then you get destroyed, and then they stand up and laugh at you, and then you quietly walk out of the arcade.
What's your go-to?
I like any weapons fighter.
Yeah.
I'm playing a lot of For Honor right now, actually, on
Xbox
One.
Look at that little plug.
We got to get back to what's going on here at GDC because we got a lot going on. One of the other areas we're focused on is something that's really throughout all of Team Xbox, which is the Gaming for Everyone initiative, Phil. I want to see if we can talk about that for a moment.
Yeah, and this GDC is an important place for us because it's where the industry comes together. And
right.
We started Gaming for Everyone inside of the Xbox, but we've always viewed that our role in the industry is something that's critically important to this. We think about our products, we think about our teams, and we think about the industry in which we work. And it's really been great to see the way the industry, not led by us anyway, I think we're just a participant in an industry that's trying to create the most inclusive work environment and inclusive content that we can create. The Women of Gaming event that's done here, the Blacks in Gaming, Latinos in Gaming events that's done down here, LGBTQ events that happen. It's just It's one of the reasons I love coming to GDC, because this is not so much of a press event. It's not so much of a, you know, what's your booth look like, or how many new games did you announce? It's the industry coming together and talking about what we want to stand for. And to be part of that with our internal Gaming for Everyone initiative is really great.
Now, you talked about a couple of things there, what the booth looks like and some other stuff. Let's pivot quickly and talk about E3's coming up in a couple months.
Yeah.
How are you feeling about that?
I'm already a little nervous. I'm always nervous before I go on stage for that thing.
Yeah, but, you are.
It seems like it's tomorrow. I mean, you know this. Yeah. You do as much planning and work. You do more work than I do for E3. And it does seem like it's tomorrow. I know there have been some people that question. We made some changes.
Yeah.
At this year's E3. Our briefing is now on Sunday. It's not on Monday. I say now. Who knows what it'll be next year.
Right.
But this year we're on Sunday. You know, some of the reasons behind that, we wanted to be a little later in the day, which I think is great. So I think that works for us. Also, this time, you know, if we needed to go a little bit longer, I'm not sure I want to go a little bit longer.
Right.
But if we needed to go a little bit longer, we could, because we don't have somebody that's right after us.
Just make sure we're over by Game of Thrones. That's all I'm saying. It's right. On Sunday night. I'm
DVR. Just, okay. DVR. No, but in the past, we always wanted to be a good citizen at GDC. I'm on the ESA board. I'm the vice chair with Strauss Zelnick from 2K. And so I feel responsibility of our show to make sure that we get done in time so that the people have their briefing right after us. I'm conscious of the press and other people.
Yeah, they're usually running either EA or Sony or
somebody. Ubi or somebody's right. Like right out. And, you know, and then Sony goes. And we're all, I think, there's obviously a lot of competition, but there's also a lot of we want to work together to make E3 great.
Sure.
So this maybe gives us a little more time. We've got some, but we'll see. We'll see if we actually need to go a little bit longer.
Yeah.
The other thing was the booth. We moved the booth. We're in a different hall.
Yeah.
The booth size, from people have kind of done math right. On our booth size. There's no kind of conspiracy theory behind the size of the booth. We know consumers are coming to the booth this year, so our booth will probably feel a little different than it has in the past, because when you open up the show floor to 15,000 people who are really there to play games and maybe not stare at some of the big things that we've kind of had around.
And even the meeting rooms we always had in there.
That's right.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, that people never saw because they were behind the scenes.
That's right. So what we're trying to make sure this booth is about, and we're going to learn, so bear with us, everybody that's going to be there. We're trying to make a booth that will allow more people to play as many games, and getting, as you said, kind of our meeting rooms and everything else out of the way. It shows no lack of commitment to E3. I think E3 is an incredibly important point for our industry and something that we're committed to make great, and I can't wait to see all of our fans down there.
Yeah, it's gonna be fun this year. And yes, we will. We talked about this on Twitter. We'll have a fan event. We don't know what it is. We'll have something.
We might know what it is. We might not say what it is. I think it'll be.
We can't give everything up right away. All right, now, Chris. Before I let you and Phil go, do you have any final words you want to talk about with the ID at Xbox program? Like, how do people get involved, and what should they look forward to?
No, I mean, if you want to make a game, come to xbox.com/ID. Other than that, we're super excited. We had, you know, tens of millions of people play ID games last year.
How many ID games did we ship?
450.
450.
Yeah. And in 2016, we just got to see these numbers, and I'm sort of excited about it. We had 1 billion hours of ID games played in 2016, which seems like a sweet
Are you
number.
Serious?
Yeah, it's amazing. It's awesome.
A billion hours?
1 billion hours. That's like no joke.
That is incredible. Are we counting like Minecraft as an ID game?
No. This is just games that are in the ID at Xbox program.
That's fantastic.
Phil is stunned. First time Phil's hearing this news right here. I'm just as stunned as you are.
I mean,
that's great. Good job.
Chris has done a really great job. I think when we launched the Xbox One, we were behind in supporting independent developers. I feel like I can say that.
Yeah.
We put a team together.
A great team
who, Katie, like the whole team that you've got here that's really driving the ID program, and I should go through and list everybody. That's a great accomplishment for the developers, obviously, but as a member of the team and a member of the Xbox community, I want to thank you, because that's really great.
Yeah, I mean, thank the developers. I mean, it's all the devs, right? Like, they're amazing.
But the first thing I ask when I'm on the floor, and I know I'm going to drag us out here, is I always say, like, how's our team supporting you? And then the first thing they ask me is, I've never seen you before and you've done nothing for my game. That's me. And I'm like, so I get that. But then when they talk about the people who are actually helping our account managers and stuff, the teams are always so positive about the way Chris and his team engage with them for the press events here to help them get kits, answer questions.
Are you telling me the ID and Xbox about. People, they're looking at you sideways like, who are you?
No, they're teasing. I'm kidding. No, I mean, I realize, you know, I'm not the one that's doing the hard work to make sure these games get set up.
You're
here,
not troubleshooting that shader
the
for
the 450 games, you know, right. Making sure that enabling a billion hours of gameplay to get done. That's Chris and his team.
It's Wally.
Great. Is it?
I'm going to just call out Wally right here for everybody. It is Wally. Yeah.
I don't know who Wally is, but thank you, Wally. So
it's great.
Devs know who he is.
No, but when we started the ID program, there was a, you know, is this a good thing or a bad thing for the for us on Xbox? I remember those debates before I was in this job, and to see what it's turned into, and I think some of the most creative and innovative things that have hit our platform have come through that, from Ark to Astroneer to the things we're seeing here. You know, some really great, whether it's game preview or just directly into ID, it's fantastic.
Now that's actually begs a good question here, Chris. How should people think of the creators program announcement that we had this week at GDC, and how does it work, and how should it sit next to ID at Xbox? Explain that for folks.
Yeah, I think that's actually, you just said it. It sits next to ID at Xbox. It's a great opportunity for, you know, there'll be professionals in there, but there'll also be makers and educators and experimenters and folks doing games that are just different than traditional commercial games. But it doesn't change, you know, ID at Xbox isn't going away. Like, we're still here, and, you know, we actually anticipate there'll be games that start in the creators program, and then once they launch and the dev sort of figures things out and, you know, starts to get some traction, they'll probably bring that game into ID to get access to full suite of Xbox Live capabilities. So,
and Wally.
Yeah, and Wally, exactly.
And apparently the police are coming to get Chris. If I they know, heard exactly. that. I don't know.
He was looking a little shifty there. They came close. He's like, oh, I gotta get out of here.
I used to live in San Francisco. I get
they still know. They're here. Yeah. Charla's back in town.
So that's how people should think about it. It's a complement to our existing programs.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Like, we're adding something new to address like a new category of developer, and we're super stoked about it.
Well, I think
they found him.
I think they found him.
Right. Is there a reward?
We're gonna. This is like a weird episode of GTA. Anyway, Phil, I'm gonna let you go, but I didn't know if you had any final words for anybody about our GDC here, or maybe even look forward to E3.
You know, the same thing I kind of push on all the time. I love our community of Xbox gamers. They've been incredibly supportive. It was nice to get online this morning and see the response to Game Pass. I don't think Game Pass is just one of those signals that we get from the community. When we do things that they like, it's very positive. When we do things that they question, we get the feedback.
Yep.
The passion and commitment they have to our product and our brand is the fuel that kind of keeps our team going and pushing us to try to do more, try to do better, and live up to their expectations. So thanks, everybody. It's great to be down here at GDC, and for those people I'll see here at GDC come up, I'd love to say hi to you.
And I also want to point out that you mentioned that.
I'm going to say that after GDC, huh? Yeah.
Yeah, that's okay. But I want to point out the blog post that you mentioned. I'll put a link to that in the show notes. And do you have any final words you want to say, Chris?
No, thanks to all the players, and thanks to all the devs, and bye.
All right, I'll put links to their Twitter handles as well. You can IOCat and Xbox.
IOCat. IOCat. You got to follow at IOCat.
All right, man. All right, we'll talk to you guys later. Thanks for joining me.
Thanks, Larry.
Thanks.
Joining me in the studio is Dan Miter from the Battlefield franchise. Community Manager Dan, so good to see you.
Yeah, it's good to see you too, man.
First of all, thank you for coming in here. We had you on this week on Xbox. Always good to see you there. But now we're going to go a little bit further into what we're talking about, which is some of the great stuff going on Battlefield 1. First of all, congratulations on an incredible launch, and you guys have just had great momentum.
We have had a tremendous amount of success ever since, you know, reveal back in last May, which... breaking records all over Twitch.
Yeah.
Breaking records on YouTube. There's an insatiable...
Was that last May already?
That was last May.
That's right. I came down and we did that last May on campus.
Mm-hmm.
And then you talked more about the campaign at TwitchCon, which was in the fall.
Yep.
And then, of course, you guys had that amazing release where that was fun.
Yeah.
That stream was fun.
It was, man. We had some moments.
We did, sure did. But anyway, I wanted to get you in here because obviously you're in town, but to talk about some of the things you guys have recently announced, can you kind of give us the headlines, then we'll kind of go deep on each of them?
Yeah, so we've announced the full lineup of expansion packs coming up. So the first one dropping March 14th is They Shall Not Pass, and that's the French army finally making it into Battlefield 1.
And how will that reveal itself? Are they foes? Are they friends? What are you doing here?
So you're playing as the French army. Okay. Obviously, you could play as the other armies
as well.
But you are defending your homeland on the Western Front.
Okay.
So you're in that beautifully clad blue uniforms with the...
Stylish.
Oh, dude, you're... very much a stylish
French.
Oh,
there we go.
Oui, oui.
Oui, oui.
Coming to my French. And you're shooting all the weapons that you would see in World War One with the French army.
Yeah.
But you also have access to the behemoth.
Yeah, what is that? So, I mean, we know what behemoths are in the game, but which one did you, bring it for this?
So this one's the Char 2C.
Okay.
Yeah. It's a basically a mobile behemoth where, you know, you had previously the train, which is on rails. This one, you go anywhere on the map.
Right.
You get your whole squad in there. You have a huge cannon on it, you know, outfitted with all sorts of other artillery guns on the side, and an incredible amount of armor and everything.
It's a beast.
It's a beast.
Yeah.
It's a beast. But that's not the only thing that's, you know, obviously coming up in They Shall Not Pass.
So how many people does it hold? How many? The 4 or 5?
You can fit your whole squad in there.
So for the whole squad in there. And then I'm sure because it's French, it probably has a little dining area in it.
Yeah, there's a place
espresso
you cut
machine.
Some brie. Yeah.
Oh, one must travel in comfort.
Absolutely. Right. And you got to be stylish.
There you go.
So there's access to 4 new maps as well. That is Verdun Heights, Fort DeVaux, Soissons, and Rupture.
And tell us about each one of those and what you guys are doing.
Yeah,
there.
So Verdun Heights is this infantry only map. It's super brutal. And it's basically this action inside an inferno taking place in the first days of Verdun.
Okay.
You know, and so Verdun has been a very pivotal location in World War One. So finally get to play that.
Right.
Fort DeVaux is more of a smaller scale map. So if you're aware, Battlefield 4 had a kind of like an operation locker.
Yeah.
And so very close quarters.
Yeah.
This is our take on that. And so you're going to get that insane close quarter combat. So you could be turning a corner, there's a grenade, run the other way.
Yeah, it's interesting because when I think Battlefield, certainly you've had those close quarter maps in the past, but Battlefield to me is those epic, wide sweeping landscapes where you're playing and things are flying and shooting. And it's close quarters, you kind of have to, you rethink it a little bit because there's not usually the vehicles and the behemoths, right?
Yeah, They Shall Not Pass has a little flavor for everybody.
Okay.
Yeah. So then you have Soissons, which is the classic large-scale Battlefield map. So bringing it back to that Battlefield DNA. And in this one, you're featuring the French tank assault against the German defenses. So this is the biggest tank assault battle that you'll see.
Right.
And then we round it out with Rupture.
Right.
And this is a maze of dead tank wreckage. But the key one here is these incredible poppy flowers all over the map.
Oh, the poppy field, sure.
Yeah. So, you know, you get this incredible contrast of the red fields with the blue skies with just brutality all around
right,
you.
Right. Yeah. And then it's, you know, it's been such an amazing launch that you guys had and the incredible reception. I want to talk to you about, were you surprised at how well World War One was received in terms of gameplay? Because I know a lot of people kind of looked at you guys and, wait a minute, what is going on here? But you guys delivered.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yes and no.
Yeah.
So, you know, our core, the franchise was built on World War II.
Sure.
And we knew that people wanted to take a step back again, but how far?
Yeah.
And yeah, sure. I think you could say that we took a risk, but you know what? That risk totally proved out.
Right.
People wanted to see World War I done right.
Right.
And your first conception is, oh, trench warfare, and you'd be stuck in a hole all day.
Yeah.
Well, that's not the reality of World War
I. It can be if you want it to be.
Sure.
But that's not it.
Yeah. No, but you know, Battlefield 1 really showcases World War I for what it is.
Yeah.
And, there was a lot of emotions in that war.
Yeah.
And we captured that in the single player as well.
Let's talk about some of the other announcements you made. Mm-hmm. You've got a lot of content coming up. You guys have kind of lifted up your head. You've been busy working on the game and working on your plans, and now you've revealed them. So let's talk about the longer range plans, if you don't mind.
Yeah. So next expansion pack is going to be In the Name of the Tsar.
Okay.
And that's the Russian front. Takes place in predominantly snow maps.
As you would expect in Russia.
Absolutely. You're staying warm, but man, the heat of the battle is still very prevalent.
Yeah.
You know, so you're going to see just burning heaps of, you know, tank wreckage and gunfire.
And blinding white landscape.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's going to be a sniper haven, but also some really awesome close quarter combats as well.
Yeah, I remember. Yeah. That's I love that. I love that style. So what else you got?
So expansion pack 3, turning tides.
Yeah.
And then finally we're rounding out with Apocalypse. So there's a lot of information we're gonna be sharing in the next coming months especially as we lead up to those expansion packs.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna save it there.
No, it's okay.
I'm not gonna dive too much
into it. You've given up so much right now in terms of what you got. You guys went quiet for a while, which is great, you know, because you went through the holiday, you shipped the game, you're updating it, you know, taking care of some things. But now you kind of say, okay, here we go, and here's our plan. It's really exciting to see what you guys have done with the franchise in terms of experimenting with it and having fun with the gameplay and the environments. What are some of the things you guys learned from World War One from the experience? You know.
Yeah, so World War One, like I stated earlier, there's a brutality to it.
Yeah.
There's this visceral, like, hand-to-hand combat that you didn't necessarily pick up because, like, again, like, the conception was that it was all in trench warfare.
Right.
But no, this is the first time that you saw a tank in actual battle.
Yeah.
So enter the Mark V tank.
Yeah.
You saw a lot of different new innovative ways of, unfortunately, you know, delivering death upon your foes.
Yeah.
Bringing in pigeons as bombers. You know, that's something that actually happened in World War One.
Yeah.
Something that maybe we can consider, you know, in the future for gameplay. But there's all these little moments in World War One that we try to capture. Obviously, Battlefield 1 isn't a direct, accurate representation of the war, but it's certainly inspired by it. And you see that in all the weapons and the vehicles in that environment that we create.
It's also, you know, the first time we really had large-scale chemical warfare.
Yeah.
Right? With mustard gas and whatnot. And, of course, we see that in the game. Everyone's got you've always got your mask at the ready, right, on your controller.
Yeah.
So it's different with that, too. What are you guys, you know, you're looking forward into 2017. What's next? I mean, you just went through the whole list. It's got to be an exciting place to be right now.
Yeah. So not only do we have the big major expansion packs, that obviously we could dive into a little bit of premium pass.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's do that.
Oh yeah, sure. Okay, and then we'll dive into some of the other stuff.
Yeah, let's pause. Yeah. Talk premium pass, and then we'll go into dive into the other stuff.
So premium pass, as we all know, or some who don't know,
yeah,
it's an additional service that allows access to all of our expansion packs. You're going to get 2 weeks early access to every single one, direct to your Xbox.
Which that alone is great.
Yeah.
But then you guys plus it.
And then we plus it, yeah. You got additional battle packs, 14 of them. You got 14 dog tags. You got server priority queue, you know, so you're going to hop in before everybody else.
Front of the line, please.
On top of all sorts of other stuff coming up.
Right.
So the other stuff.
Yeah.
So in between all of our expansion packs, in between the premium pass perks, we're also continually updating the game.
Yeah.
So every... so often we'll be introducing game improvements,
yeah,
you know, tweaking the game, making sure this game is fun for everybody, no matter what class you play, assault, recon, support.
Right.
We're always updating and we're always looking for feedback.
Yeah.
So we just recently introduced the Battlefield 1 community test environment.
Well, tell us about that.
Yeah. So if you are a premium pass owner,
mm-hmm.
You could hop into a test environment called the CTE
mm-hmm.
and, right now,
community test environment.
Community test environment. Yeah. Right now, it's only available on PC.
Right.
But this allows us to play and test unreleased features before we even roll it out to the public.
Sure.
Some of the stuff may not even make it to the public.
It's a sandbox.
It's a sandbox.
Just have fun. Come in. You may see things you like. You may see things you won't like. You may see things that ship. You may see things that don't.
There might be things that you want to suggest, and that maybe we'll run with it, and you might see it actually in CTE.
Yeah. I mean, that's I've you know, been in the games industry a long time, like yourself, and I've seen other games internally. I'll go play an internal build where they put different things. Hey, what do you think of this? And that's even better because you're kind of crowdsourcing some ideas, and hey, let's try this. And it may by that exact idea, but maybe it has a spark into something else. You just never know.
Yeah. And we have a lot of fun too. We'll do holiday things. So like in Battlefield 4, you know, during the holiday season, everybody had snowman heads.
Yeah.
And you're shooting, you know, you got some crazy assault rifle. Yeah.
Why not?
Halloween, you have all these little pumpkins everywhere and you're shooting them and confetti go flying everywhere.
What about, you could do anything for Easter? Am I going to bunny ears?
Maybe a couple eggs around
this
there.
Is not an announcement. It's not an announcement. Well, that sounds like a lot of fun. Well, listen, Dan, I appreciate you coming in and chatting with us. It's been a delight, and it's always good to see you. Great to see you, man. And I guess we'll look forward to the updates in the future. We'll have you back on the show.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, my
friend.
Sounds
good. Thanks, Larry. See you on the battlefield.
So GDC, very busy, not just, as Phil mentioned, the Xbox Live Creators Program and Xbox Game Pass, but this is the time of year we always put together an event, Chris Charla does, where we show off some of the most promising ID at Xbox titles that are becoming to Xbox One and Windows 10.
Yeah, this is just a slice of them. You heard about that in the interview.
Exactly. And some of them were seen for the first time. So Ooblets, which we had mentioned last week, was getting a lot of buzz this week. Something that's got me particularly excited, Wargroove. This is made from the creators of Starbound, Chucklefish Games. They also helped bring Stardew Valley to Xbox One, which I can't stop playing. So Wargroove...
Are you playing it by yourself?
Yeah, it's a single player game.
No, I didn't know if you were playing with your daughter.
Oh, no. I don't want her, you know, this is my farm. She's going to tell me where to plant the cauliflower, and I will disagree.
Okay.
Plus...
We're also disagreeing on whether or not Abigail is who I should be going after.
I see. You know, so there's. So I see.
You know, there's.
It's rife for
she can manage her own, her own farm and her own life. But Wargroove. Wargroove is. I don't know if you ever played Advanced Wars.
Yep.
Or Advanced Wars, like for, it started on the Game Boy Advance, and it's a handheld franchise that we've seen on the Nintendo side. This game is very much inspired by that. So just looking at it, and I'll link to it, we have a trailer, actually a post from the team at Chucklefish Games. This game looks really good. So yeah. If you're in this turn-based strategy that's sort of like very lighthearted and very simple graphics, but like really cool, and it's got an editor and all kinds of stuff. Anyway, if the word Advanced Wars works for you or Fire Emblem works for you, this is something you're going to want to keep your eyes open.
All right.
Another game, The Escapist 2. First Escapist, very successful. Mm-hmm. Enough that we'll be seeing Escapist 2. I believe it will be later this year. Later this year. And Trove, which is coming this week, or next week, I should say, a free-to-play adventure MMO, has a voxel look, kind of Minecraft-esque. Obviously, it's going to be a different type of game. It's an MMORPG, but an action RPG, but that will be coming out soon. It's free, cool. So no reason not to check it out.
Yep.
And it's March. Smarch. Lousy smarch weather.
Is it?
Yeah. Well,
it's when did it get to be March?
So that means games with gold. There's the one half where it's like, wow, it's March already. I'm one step closer to death. But then there's the other part of it being March already, which is, hey,
another
new games.
Game.
Yeah,
one step closer to death.
I know.
That's one way to look at it. Dark.
not as dark as the Denny's Twitter was this week.
Don't link off to that.
Yeah, you need to start doing some zoom in Twitter fad photos, Larry. Mm. I don't think that's going to happen. So anyway, Layers of Fear and Borderlands 2.
In a world.
Yes. I was very impressed with that. You doing side work? You know, are you cutting trailers?
I'm just saying.
Look, what you do after hours is not necessarily my business.
I have fun with it. I have my little microphones and I'll sit in the corner.
This is true.
Just read my own. You can see I'm transcribing game trailers and reading them back. That's what I'm doing with my spare time.
That's how all the professional VO people, they
I know.
They're not, you know, stomping into the studio in LA. They live wherever they live.
Yep.
I used to work with a guy named Jim Cutler, and you would know him because he does like all of, like the Turner Broadcasting, TNT, if you ever
hear
like
dudes.
Basketball, all those. Yeah, he does tons of stuff. You would know the guy's voice. Guy just lives in a house somewhere in like Long Island or something. And
that's the way to do it.
He just records like all day long.
In
his house.
Nice. Yeah.
And then
they have I have a lot of friends who have their home studios, and they just I mean, my studio is not as good as like some of these people have, but yeah, you record in your house, you have ISDN, you shoot it, but done.
It was ISDN.
I know.
Very good. Those two. And then in the middle of the month, just after the Ides, will be Evolve and Heavy Weapon. So new games to play now.
Those are great.
And a couple games want to talk about that came out this week. One, an RPG I've been hearing good things about from our friend Jez Corden over at Windows Central. Torment, Tides of Numenera. So if you're deep, you love RPGs, you want something that's a little deep and a little more, I would say, total fantasy. It looks like super complex and there's a lot going on, sort of a choose your own adventure sort of thing. Lots of different endings. It's not super linear. Tides of Numenera is waiting for you. And then new battle mode came to Minecraft, the Fallout Battle Maps. I don't know if you've played battle mode, but it is really fun. You can just like play really quick. I like the ones where you're throwing snowballs at folks and you're just sort of dropping them in the lava. There's a lot of different stuff. It's a fun way to play. Anyway, if you like Fallout, you like Minecraft, it's the Reese's Peanut Butter Cup. It's chocolate in your peanut butter.
There you go.
Nice.
And finally, just wrapping it up, Halo Wars 2, if you haven't tried it yet.
Yes.
Tisk tisk.
There's a demo.
Demo.
You have no excuse. Right. You have zero excuse.
No. None whatsoever. So that is available now.
That's a lot of news.
It was
Game Pass. We had Phil and Chris to come on. We had a lot to talk about, Jeffrey.
Yeah.
It's a big gaming
week. I don't even know what to say.
You want to talk about next week, people will hear from us?
PAX East?
Yeah.
Sure, we can talk about PAX East. The show will be Saturday, I think it's 1 o'clock. Saturday at 1 o'clock, we'll be in our one of the big places there. Laura will be there. You're joining us on the East Coast. Jeffrey will be there.
Always happy.
Of course, I'm always there
because
it's going home for me. Mm-hmm. Trying to get my mom to go.
So good.
To come to the podcast.
Put her on the panel.
I don't know.
Tell us stories. Look, here's what I know. I don't know a lot, but here's what I know.
Yes.
Is every time anything is dredged up from your past, especially like the pre-Xbox, it's always good.
It is always good. Like the clown college?
That was fantastic. Like, and you're always wearing really short shorts.
I have that photo. Should I show Laura?
Oh.
The hot dog stand photo.
So now, Laura, this photo... Yeah. I don't want to show this to you.
So yesterday, we're in a meeting, and Larry opens up his bag, and he's like, ugh. And he just closes his bag immediately. He's like, what is it? He goes, my wife put something in the bag. And I can see it's a photo. And I'm like, there's going to be short shorts in this photo.
Yeah.
It did not disappoint.
Laura, do you have an analyst appointment this week? Because you may want to make one after you take a look at that. So that's me and a friend of mine.
A friend. A lady friend. So, oh, my, that's my grandma.
Back in the day.
How old were you?
In college.
Yeah. So like about 20.
Thank you.
And there's amazingly 80s.
Yeah. I'm not going to be. Where do those come?
Like it's bright green.
Yeah.
With
anyway, enough about
white squares.
No, I'm not posting that on the internet, guys. You're on your own. Anyway,
so, yeah, 1:30.
Would you share that with your meeting?
Pardon me.
Did you share that with your meeting?
No.
Okay. Good.
No, Jeff. I shared it with Jeff.
I think we need to share it with the panel.
No, we don't. We'll be doing the panel. This is actually the first time I'm going to reveal who's going to be on the panel.
You are.
We have somebody from Mass Effect coming by to talk about Mass Effect Andromeda.
Who is it?
I'm not going to reveal everything yet. But it's. Would you like me to tell you who it is? Who you want to? Do you want to play 50 questions and see if you can figure it out?
Is it Mike Gamble?
It may be.
Okay.
It may be.
That was first question.
I talked to Mike Gamble on Twitter. We've never met, so I really hope it's Mike Gamble.
We'll have details on next week. So it's because I never like to commit. I mean, I know the subject. I just don't know the names because people get busy.
Look, that game went gold. There's no excuse for one, him not to bring a copy for me and you guys, I suppose. And then two, for them to be there.
Yeah. Oh,
I can't believe Andromeda is coming out so soon.
I know.
Where are we going to find the time?
We're going to have that. We may have some other guests as well.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
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 You're looking at me. Did I miss a to-do?
I guess something's not funny.
Oh, yes. It's kind of funny.
So we're trying to get Greg Miller to come on the show, yep. Who has a very popular, I guess, PlayStation fanboy podcast, right?
They're a comedy out. They do have a PlayStation podcast, but that is not their only
thing. Anyway, maybe if he and I were going back and forth on Twitter, you could see that there. We're trying to get him on the show.
That's great.
But yeah, so we're really excited about that. We'll be out there on Saturday. It's actually Mac Walters. He's the creative director of Andromeda.
Okay.
So he's going to join us.
All right. Well, fantastic. I'll look up Mac.
You can find him on Mac Walters Live on Twitter. So. But I'll put a link to that, or Jeffrey will put it in the show notes.
Yep. Super exciting.
But we're going out there, so I don't know. I have no idea what they're going to talk about. I figure the game is out in a week. They got to have something to talk about. Mm-hmm. So that's the way we do that. We'll probably have something to give away. Who knows? We just have some fun. We want to meet you, our East Coast fans, or at least...
Bring your good questions.
They always bring good questions, don't they?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying. Think about it.
Yeah, so Mac's going to join us. He's the creative director, BioWare, for... He's coming out of Edmonton, so Edmonton, Canada. I've been there. I've been to that studio. Have you been up there, Jeff?
I've never been to Alberta.
Really?
At all.
I just realized I've been to Edmonton twice.
Did you go to the mall?
Yeah, I had to. I cut the ribbon at the Microsoft store at Edmonton Mall.
Isn't that the biggest mall? Isn't it bigger than Mall of America or something crazy?
Yeah, it's redonkulously big.
Yeah. Let's all go to the mall.
Yes.
No, that was a scary place. no, Jeffrey, no, we're not doing that. Anyway, so that'll be next week. We've got a busy week next. So that's no show next Thursday, but we'll do the show live. I believe it's going to be streamed. So if you want to join us and maybe ask some questions on the stream, if we're able to do that, we will do it. If not, then well, you're on your own.
Very good. That's super exciting. Can't wait to talk Mass Effect.
Yeah.
It'll be so much fun.
So
Mac, if you're listening, you know. I told them, I'll bring my Xbox.
I told them I needed to, you know, play the game at least before I did the interview,
right?
See, that's smart.
Content.
It's the least you can do, right? I must sound intelligent, or try to be at least, in a world.
Maybe there's an announced trailer or a release trailer that you can cut.
Yes, yeah.
I don't know.
In a galaxy.
In a galaxy.
Far away.
With a femship.
You got to go femship or fem rider. I guess so.
I made my Ghost Recon. I made my character female.
Cool.
I want to hear who the voices are. I mean, femship was Jennifer Hale. No offense to Dude Shep, Bro Shep, but she's the better talent. And so I can tell you
this is the one thing I can share with you about Mass Effect. I probably should wait until the panel, but I will reveal it here. I am not in the game. I am not doing the voiceover for the game, so I just want to be very clear on that.
Refund.
Yeah, I'm sure you're disappointed, Laura. I'm sure you're disappointed. All right, so we've got that coming up. After that, yeah, it's crazy because, you know, we all fly out there. We do the show. We hang out there for the day, and then Laura, you're gonna did you book your flight yet?
Not yet.
Why don't you do that?
You should probably do that.
I don't want to do that.
Larry's already in middle seat territory.
Yeah, no, okay. This is true story. Look,
I always have to sit in middle.
In fact, I went to check in today, mm-hmm. and I sent Jeff the photo, and I was like, dude.
Only there's at least a lot of middle seats.
There's a lot of middle seats.
You can lean all the way back. In that
if you're on our flight, then you want 9C. Because he's in A, I'm in B, you can be in C. Although, actually, we're going to put you in B because you're smaller.
I am smaller. I usually get the middle.
We'll pre-board because we'll need a little extra time.
Yeah, we'll just need that little extra time to get to our destination. Anyway, so we're looking forward. Oh, so you'll definitely see Jeff and I out there. We don't know if you'll see Laura.
I'll try my best.
You may want to book an Amtrak and leave now.
Yeah.
How long does it take to get cross-country in Amtrak?
We don't have those Japanese high speed rails. We don't exactly have the Shinkansen.
It's a leisurely trip. We'll say that.
To ride in like a boxcar. I'm sure.
All right. Why don't we do Name the Game? Do we have time for Name the Game?
Sure do.
You sure, Laura?
Let's do Name the Game. Name the Game from last week, and it was For Honor.
Yes.
It's a good one.
Yes.
And the winner?
La La Land.
You gotta walk that one back.
Nope. Not that.
What is the winner? Who's the winner? The winner.
He's not the winner.
Wait a minute. There's been a mistake. This is not a joke.
The winner is Rocky from Denver, Colorado.
Rocky!
Congratulations, Rocky.
Yep.
You have a boatload of prizes.
Do you? Oh, really?
Yes. I cleaned out your office.
Or, I don't know. You go. I don't know where you find this stuff.
It just keeps appearing in your office.
I know. Well,
and then it keeps disappearing.
Yes, that's right.
It's you never know.
Easy come, easy go.
It's in receiving and it's in shipping, out receiving. Go ahead.
Exactly. So, Rocky, you get a copy of Gwent.
Yay.
Witcher card game.
Yep.
I'm just now in game preview.
Yep. Get beta for that code.
Shipload of gold for Battle Islands Commanders, which is a free to play game.
Yep.
And you get a car that is a $99 value.
What?
I know.
Where did I have that?
I don't know. Your keyboard.
I know. Is that what that was?
Yes. Okay. Then you get a copy of Kill All Zombies, which is an ID Xbox game.
Yep.
Should be pretty fun.
That's fun.
Ikimo, Splinters of the Dark Shard, another game from ID Xbox.
Lots of ID at Xbox games in here.
Secret Mine, also
Jeffrey.
From ID Xbox. Yep. Copy of IO.
Rocky, what are you doing to me? You're cleaning me out.
Cleaning him out. And also gets a copy of Torment, Tides of Numenera.
See, that'll keep you busy.
Yep.
And Cessna All, copy of Halo Wars 2.
Woo! Congratulations, Rocky.
That is a boatload of games.
That was the Rocky 4 of prizes, not the Rocky 5.
Rocky, congratulations. And if you're listening to this saying, I want in on the prize as well, Laura's going to tell you how you can win these prizes. Go ahead, Laura.
I'll clean out Larry's office again next week. Geez, I'm sure it'll just, like, they grow on trees in Larry's office.
I like to share the wealth. I think you both know that. And the listeners, yes. I think you guys know that.
Very, very good. So it's super easy. All you have to do is listen to the sound effects that I'm just about to play, and then let us know what game that is.
All right, so you ready?
Yep, let's roll the sound effects.
Hornet reporting, over.
Infantry level 1 researched.
So that's it. If you think you know what game those sounds are from, just send us an email, lollipop@xbox.com and ccmajor@xbox.com. Let us know what game that is. If you want to, you can include your name. We like to know people's names, gamertag. But if you don't want to, that's cool too. We respect your privacy.
And if you, look, if you want to tell us your real name and then give us a fake name for us to mention on the air, we're happy to do that. Keep it clean.
Are you thinking that Rocky's not his real name?
I knew a Rocky. Did you know a Rocky? Well, you live in Philadelphia. Of course you did.
No, of course I knew a Rocky.
So
that's not even a Philly accent.
Did you know a Rocky when you were living in Texas?
No.
Do you know a Tex?
I don't think so. I don't think so. I think maybe a few dogs were named Tex.
Oh, okay.
No people.
No actual people. Okay. Well, good luck to everybody who's listening and can recognize that game. Give us an email, win some prizes, hang out with us. What?
The cow's name was Tex.
What cow? Oh, that cow.
Yes.
The cow that you were telling us.
The pet cow was named Tex.
Now it's all coming back.
That just hit
Do you remember the pet cow?
What?
You were here for that. Laura had a pet cow that was her friend's cow.
It was my friend's cow. It was not my cow.
Right.
But its name was Tex because it had a patch on the side that was almost in the shape of Texas.
So was this repressed? Did this end badly?
Dear listeners, I wish you could have seen the light that went on in Laura's head. I saw and I was stunned.
It just took a few seconds for my brain to reconnect place. But because you had asked me last time we talked about the cow, what the name was, and I couldn't remember.
Right. Now you remember.
Now I remember.
Of course it was Tex.
Of course it was.
All right. Well, we're kind of kind towards...
Is there something you're not going to bring up?
Okay, go ahead.
He's not going to talk about himself.
No.
But I would like to mention a congratulations to our own host.
Oh, no, we're not going to do that.
Right, her... has been promoted.
Oh, all right.
So I remember seeing, back before I worked here, you'd be introduced oftentimes as the director of Xbox Live programming or something like that.
Right.
Then I came here and anyone who works here, like when you're sending an email to them, like it populates a little picture.
It autofills, yeah.
And then you can like sort of mouse over and see what their position is. And,
like a director of test or
senior manager. Senior manager of marketing this or something
like that.
Mm-hmm. Right. When you mouse over Larry, it just says Major Nelson.
Yes.
I'm the only one in the company. 100,000 people. I'm the only one.
So they sent the email out and it said, so-and-so is now senior director and so-and-so is now a manager.
Right.
And it just said, Larry, Major Nelson.
That's right.
Larry is still Major Nelson.
Lieutenant Colonel Nelson.
No.
Which if we were following, the proper rankings, actually by now you'd probably be some level of brigadier general. Or
I'd be 4-star.
Field marshal.
I don't even know.
Yes.
How many prestiges?
Certainly not commander-in-chief.
So welcome.
Thank you.
RIP Major Nelson, long live Major Nelson.
Well, exactly. Well, that's very kind of you, Jeffrey. I don't like talking about myself. I'm very humble.
That's why I did it.
That's why I don't do selfies. That's why I don't do any of that stuff, because I'm here for you, the gamers. You want to know what's going on here at Xbox, and I try to connect you with Phil and Chris and Jeff and Laura and E and Steptoe and the whole and even many, 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 many more. You know who we need to get back on the show? James Lithion.
We do.
Yeah.
We haven't heard him in a while.
You know what he's working on?
Farrah.
His Farrah as well. He's a good Farrah in Overwatch. He was working on Game Pass.
Yeah, I saw his tweet. Huh.
Yeah, he's been working on that he and I have been talking about that. So I gotta get him on the show to talk about that.
That'd be great. So many things. What a big week.
It has been a big week, and we're gonna be off next week, but not really off. We're just gonna delay the show by a couple days so that we can get it posted for you. I'm working on some travel coming up. We're working on E3, of course. Jeff, you're going to E3 this year, right? It's your 10th year in a row?
I'm always going to E3.
10th year, right?
This will be my 11th.
11th.
Wow. Yeah. I'm old.
Thanks.
How many is this for you?
57. No, I don't remember. It's 14, 15, 16.
It's a lot of trips to E3.
Yeah, I don't remember.
Like Jeff Keighley's been all of them.
Yeah, I don't know about that. he started when they were in Atlanta.
Yeah.
So it was...
And I thought it was warm inside the LA Convention Center. Woo! Can you imagine being in Atlanta
no,
in July?
No, thank you.
With 30,000 of your closest friends?
No, thank you. We did see... well, actually, you heard Phil talk about that, the E3 booth. So we probably saw... Some people saw where our booth is going to be at the expo. Excited about that.
South Hall?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Got our event on Sunday.
That's kind of cool.
I think I'm doing a broadcast again. I don't know.
The usual.
Yeah, we talked about this last week. We don't need to go over it again. All right, gang. So, Laura, I need you to, your to-do item this week is.
Homework?
Yes, you do.
What?
You got to book an airplane.
That's true.
Okay.
That's true.
Now, let me just tell you, if Laura can't get on a flight internet, you know what to do. Because although we could just bring you in remotely like we do with Jeff last year.
You have
to start playing Dark Souls.
I do know you like to come to Boston for your lobster rolls.
Do.
Jeff and I are going to go get that. We're going to go get the baked potato with
the judo baked potato.
We're going to go to, I tell you, we're going to go to that place again. If you want to go with us, we'll go there.
See what happens with my potato.
All right, gang. We'll talk to you guys next time. You can find us online. You can find Laura over there on Twitter
at LauraLifeHelp.
And Jeffrey's over
at Jeff Rubenstein.
Of course, I'm at Major Nelson. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye.